And this is where I would like to start talking about agriculture and try to define and share with you what the problem actually is. So this is the kind of official, widely accepted view of the agricultural challenge, which actually, to some extent, I disagree, and I'll try to explain my point. So the general consensus is that by 2050, the human population will reach 10 billion people, and what this means is that we will need also the level of nutrition will rise. For instance, in China, people are much more demanding in terms of what kind of food they eat, and so we will need to increase the food production by 70%. To put this in context, today humankind uses 70% of all arable lands. So all 70% of all land on Earth that can be farmed is already farmed. So if you contrast it against this number here, you see that there is a massive problem. And it's a completely open problem. Nobody has a solution to it. Nobody knows how to even start addressing it. And this is just a cartoon, how it looks. It's this is a very familiar exponential curve of how human population grows. And the question is whether we'll be able to produce enough food without basically destroying our environment completely. However, this curve, this exponential curve, is very, very confusing, because it's just all these exponentials. They're not very informative, because all you see is this huge spike. So it becomes much more informative once you put it this axis on the logarithmic scale. So logarithmic scale, you just go from million, 10 million, 100 million, 1 billion, etc. So what you see here, this is over the last 12,000 years. And the pattern that emerges here is actually mind-blowing. It's what it shows is that there were actually very few significant events that happened through history that actually changed the way that humankind produced their food and interacted in the environment. It's basically the agricultural revolution, right? So that started about that happened about 7,000 years ago. So that basically when humans went from nomadic hunter-gatherer societies to actually to agriculture, to cultivating crops, which started relatively rapid growth of population. And this trend basically continued. There were several repercussions here. There were the city-states, empire-states, but basically this curve continues all the way to the Industrial Revolution. And what happened during the Industrial Revolution, that instead of using muscle power and animal muscle power, we started to use coal and then oil. And we started to use oil and coal to produce everything, and including our food. So all our food today is produced from oil, basically. It's produced from oil, soil, and water. And what this means is that we actually, these two breaking points, so I consider them as two agriculture revolutions. That's the explanation for the name of the talk. But it's basically transition of humanity between different ecological niches. Basically, every species on Earth is defined by where it takes its energy from, and what are the outputs of its existence. So between this stage and this stage, basically humans went from one ecological niche to a different ecological niche. Now what happens here, there's another here breaking point, quite significant, but it's not very visible here because the rate of growth is so significant. It's actually what is called green revolution. So it's when we started to use synthetic fertilizers. And it's also a very significant stage, but generally the ecological niche that we occupy didn't change. And this is another very telling picture, illustration, is that this is the rate of growth of our energy consumption in the last 400 years. And what is absolutely mind-blowing to me is that how constant this rate is. It's just 2.9% per year growth nothing else. It's completely steady. And if we extrapolate this curve further, then in about 200 years, if we continue to consume and raise our energy consumption at the same rate, all oceans will boil on Earth within a couple hundred years, if you just extrapolate this curve. So this means that the ecological niche that humankind occupies today is completely, utterly unsustainable. And what it means is that within our lifetime, the humankind will have to go into a different ecological niche. There are a few scenarios how this can happen. There are some pretty bad scenarios, but there are also quite good scenarios. So actually, this is another illustration, but it's less important, basically saying that all current predictions of how humankind will evolve, they rely on the assumption that the both consumption of energy of humankind will saturate. But this is unheard of. This didn't happen for thousands of years, that the human consumption of energy has saturated. But even in the most pessimistic scenarios of climate change and all this climate science, the assumption is always that it will saturate. So one thing is that absolutely has to saturate, and if it will not saturate, then the world will not be what it is today. So it will saturate one way or another, the hard way or easy way. And then, so this is the view of the actual, this is a complete description of the ecological niche that humans occupy today. It's full reliance on oil and fossil fuels, and then as an output, it's greenhouse gases, so CO2 mainly, but also methane and a few others. And the most amazing thing about this particular chart is that agriculture, together with land use change, takes about 25%, along with the transportation for agriculture, it takes 25% of all energy consumption and also 25% of all CO2 output. And the reason that is so amazing, this figure, is I'll try to give you a very specific example of an industry that we spent a lot of time studying, which is the sugarcane industry in Brazil, which is the biofuel industry. And biofuel is considered to be the future. This is considered to be a renewable source of energy. It's a very big deal, particularly in Brazil and South America. And this industry, this is the breakdown of what this industry does. In Brazil only, they have the revenue of about $70 billion, so it's a very large industry. They lose about 15% on average to various weeds, planting errors, various inefficiencies in cultivation of sugarcane. Their operational expenses are 70%. So more than half of this is purely fuel consumption. So this is a diesel for machinery, field machinery, and transportation of sugarcane. And this is so amazing, because for every 10 liters of green renewable ethanol, they actually consume about 3 liters of diesel that comes from fossil fuel. So this industry is completely oil dependent. And in the end, they have a profit margin of about 3%, the best of them. Many of them are losing money. The most efficient ones, they have, on a good year, they have 3% profit margin. And they have greenhouse gas emissions of 20 million tons per year. This is again, I'm using a lot of superlatives, but this is a mind-blowing figure, because sugarcane is actually the most efficient plant known to man to absorb carbon dioxide. So sugarcane has 10% efficiency in terms of converting light sunlight into sugar and absorbing carbon dioxide. So the fact that we managed to develop an industry growing sugarcane that is actually so carbon dioxide negative is incredible. So what can be done about this? So is the question is, it looks, so I drew a very dark picture and I'll try now to bring some spot of light into it. So this is indeed quite a dark situation. However, there's also an interesting point here. So they have this 3% profit margin, and the bio fuels ethanol is about 10 to 20% less efficient than diesel in terms of economic efficiency. Which means that if we would improve the efficiency of production of sugarcane by about 20%, it means that they would convert all their machinery to ethanol that comes from sugarcane on their fields. They would close the loop. They would break out completely the reliance on fossil fuels, and it would convert all of the $70 billion industry in completely carbon neutral. And this can be all done with existing technology within a couple of years. So what stops them from doing this? If you go to any of the agronomists or farmers in Brazil, in sugarcane industry, and you ask them, how do you, can you improve efficiency? Can I give you 3 hectares, 10 hectares of land, and you will cultivate it more efficiently than you do today? The answer is, it's easy. It's very, very easy to do it in 10 hectares. You just, if a farmer or agronomist has a 10 hectares of sugarcane, he just walks around, he knows exactly where he needs to optimize, where he needs to put more fertilizer, where he needs to put less fertilizer, where he sees there are some weeds developing, and he goes there and locally he treats. However, this is a large-scale industry, and most of these farms, they have at least 10, 20, 30,000 hectares. And you have, when you have sugarcane standing 5 meters tall, going from horizon to horizon, there's absolutely no way that you can scale the methodology that you apply on a small scale to really large scale farming. So the gap is purely knowledge. The gap is purely how can you know what is actually situational awareness, how you actually can know what is happening in large field the same way that you can know what is happening in your garden. And obviously the second question is whether you can actually act on this, and you can react and you can fix problems when you discover them. So this is what we see as the solution to this problem. So we just send this little drone with a hyperspectral camera. And hyperspectral camera, as I hope I explained to you, it allows you to really analyze with very much detail the physiological condition of plants. And you can do it on a very large scale. If the small drone is not enough for you, you can use an airplane to cover a very large area, 10,000 hectares, 20,000 hectares, etc. And then you basically deliver to the farmer a very detailed plan map with everything that is happening on their farm. So what this allows you to do, as I already mentioned a little bit, is that you can decrease losses by about 50%, and this is a result of our analysis. We're also running right now a pilot with a major producers of sugarcane in Brazil to validate these figures. But we can reduce the losses by 50%, and we can reduce the operational expenses by about 15%. So by what this will do is, as I already mentioned, this will increase the total expenses and increase the efficiency of the whole cultivation process by about between 15 to 20%. And the idea is that it will triple the profit margin of the business, of the farmer. And with a little extrapolation of this, obviously there are a few components, nothing science fiction, but with a few extra technology components, we can make these businesses, these very large businesses, this particular business is it's about half a billion annual revenue business. So we can get them completely fossil fuels free and completely carbon dioxide neutral. So just to finish off, this is all our friends. We had developed an absolutely fantastic ecosystem of organizations that support us, including the European Space Agency and the Swiss Space Center and the universities of Zurich and EPFL. And there are some very big organizations that seem to sort of believe in our potential. We have picked up quite a few prizes and mentioned in the media. And finally, I wanted to squeeze in this not very scientific analysis, that the way that my sort of reflection on innovation and in general. So there's a very strong distinction that we are making between what is data, information, knowledge. These are three separate categories. And in fact, these categories can be mathematically defined. It's not very abstract concepts. We can define them very precisely and mathematically. And basically, the difference between data and information is that you create information from data by putting it into environmental context. Not sure how this... just to give you an example, saying that this table is 50 centimeters wide is a piece of data, but it's completely useless and doesn't have any informational content if you don't have any expectation or preconception of what this table might be. So if you would just tell you table number 235 is 50 centimeters long, you can't even quantify how much information there is, because it can be 50.0 or it can be 50.0000. It can be 3 bits of information or it can be 3 terabytes of information. It's undefinable. The only way that you can create information from data is you put it into environmental context. And then the difference between knowledge and information is the existence of purpose. You can't possibly define knowledge without a purpose. So, to give you an example, if you put yourself an objective or put this table through this door, suddenly, if you have this information of this table being 50 centimeter 0.02, you can suddenly know whether you can actually push this table through the door or not. So this is the difference between knowledge and information, it's the purpose. And purpose is something that is defined by society. It's not purely objective concept. It's a very subjective, or it's intersubjective. It's defined by a wonderful book, Sapiens. There's an amazing book that I would very much recommend by Yuval Harari about what intersubjective reality is. So purpose is defined as intersubjective reality. And then intelligence is basically can be mathematically defined. Intelligence can be mathematically defined by the ability to convert data into knowledge. And then finally, technology is a toolkit that allows you to basically speed up or empower the intelligent process. You can speed up this process of conversion of data into knowledge. So what I wanted to, the reason that I'm mentioning this is that while creation of information from data can be generally automated, and it's with the amazing advances of artificial intelligence, you can actually completely automate the creation of information from data, because it's based on some relatively objective environmental variables, I would say. The creation of knowledge from information, knowledge is purely, it completely relies on this definition of purpose within a society, so you can't automate it. So the innovation, the way I see it, there are obviously is innovation in terms of creating information from data, but there's also innovation in terms of creation of knowledge from information. So I feel that going forward, there's a, the most interesting innovative concepts will come from this part of this sort of chart, complex and non-scientific chart. Basically, how we create, it's a purposeful innovation, how we create knowledge from information rather than how we create information from data, if it all makes sense. So, thank you very much. This is our wonderful team. Unfortunately, not the entire team, but most of them are actually here if you want to ask any questions. And thank you very much for your attention.